All right, very great. What I'm doing is a follow-up. This is very, very important. This is so, you follow up, you do something, you follow up and let everyone know how it's going. And this morning, doing the video of that we have no choice, that's actually the goal, is to realize we don't have any choice to make at all. And so going out, I went out and drove around the Bay Area, South Bay Area today, and visited various places and took it out into the world, you know, and I feel fine. It wasn't any problem at all. Functioned perfectly well. Saw all these techies and from all around the world. It's just like, wow. These people are very different than my generation, to say the least. And the world keeps constantly glossing over, you know, you know, the personality, what the personality does, the way it functions, is it uses the good to hide the bad. This is what the way the personality functions. It's the same thing with the world. The world's just an extension of the personality, actually. And we use the superficial to hide the madness that we're engaged in, the scam of this, of time, distance, process, and form. So on the surface, everything, people are, you know, very fit. They've got the latest hairstyles. They've got the latest clothing styles. They've got all have their smartphones. You know, a lot of them had laptops, and they're just all styling and seem very confident, you know, and well-to-do and all this kind of stuff. And in nice places, although, you know, I mean, the architecture differs throughout different epochs and eras, etc. But it's just all hiding the fact that they don't have a clue how to stop pretending, how to stop trying to hoax God. Don't even have a clue as to how to go about it. And this is the problem with this age. I say it's a very evil age, very dark age, because superficially we're seeming to progress and however you want, you know, how do I mean progress? Well, third world peoples now. I mean, there's people from all over the world I saw today. And they're carrying themselves with great, you know, confidence. But it's superficial. It's absolutely superficial. What this world is doing is this flimsy superficiality of, you know, progress and prosperity, and we're advancing because, you know, but it's utterly superficial. Oh, I can use a tablet. I can use a computer. I'm sophisticated. I can travel to a hotel. I'm sophisticated. Again, you take 100 people from what I met today, saw today, take 100 people and ask them if they have even the slightest clue how to go about salvation. Out of that 100, there wouldn't be a single one that even has the faintest clue. Okay, so how can you call this an enlightened age? It's the opposite. I call it the gilded stone age. So the smartphone stone age. They're being led back into a stone age. A spiritual stone age is what's really happening. And that's why I saw the collapsing was signified as all these stones coming down from the mountainside. What does that mean? A stone age. And everyone was buried in these stones. There were stones everywhere. And people are looking about, and there was a boulder here and a boulder there and a boulder and dust, and you know, dust meaning believing that we're just what we're created from the earth by out of dust. That's what we are. So it's a false identity, believing that we're a human body. That's a false identity. It's a stone age, not having a slightest clue how to be saved, how to be liberated, how to set down, how to evaporate our continuity fear, and accept what we are as God created us. Perfectly free spirit, formless spirit. So this is where we're headed. This is what's happening, is a collapsing, which is going to bring about a stone age, a smartphone stone age of extreme spiritual ignorance, which leads to the belief that everyone, unchallenged belief that we're really the body and the world is really our home, and this kind of stuff. This is, you know, sheer ignorance. And yet this is the times that we live in. It's the worst of the worst times. But on the surface, it seems like the best of the best times. Like, oh, that new Levi's Stadium in Santa Clara, you know. Oh. But it's a dump. I drove past it and said, what? Look at the architecture. I mean, this is horrible. I mean, most 49er fans don't even go there anymore. They say it's terrible. Steam's terrible too. Who wants to see that? You know, but mostly fans from other teams that are playing here travel to come here, you know, to watch. Easy to get tickets, cheap. I drove through all these tech places. Cisco. I mean, Cisco's got this massive campuses all over the place. It's just like incredible, you know. But so what, you know? And they're leading us into a Stone Age. Okay? Pride goeth before a fall. And we've put all our effort into a superficiality and appearances, okay, instead of spiritual practicing. This is what has happened. And you go to a hotel, and oh, they have a little Starbucks thing there. Oh, wow, you know, this is like, I live in what a great world I live in. You know, you can order. You can order something from the Starbucks cup. You can order that. Wow. they've got, you know, gluten-free muffins. Oh, geez. You know, this, we're super advanced. And on and on and on and on and on, right? This is, you know, just, you could see it's totally superficial. Everything you see is superficial. I saw a guy who was out there cleaning out cigarette butts and ash and garbage, which I know very well what that's like, actually. And I saw him, and he actually closed his eyes and for a little while. I was just walking with his eyes. He said, just because, he says, life just sucks. It's just terrible. And then he saw us. He goes, have a nice day. You know, everyone he sees, he has to say, have a nice day, as he's cleaning out the cigarette butts from this place. Oh yeah, we got, but hey, we have these big pot outdoor planting containers, really big, you know, with a palm tree in them, you know. It's like, oh wow. We got a walkway with glass over it. Oh wow, you know, like, we're really living in what a great place we live in here. But isn't what we need to know how to set down this attempt at scamming God, which we call time, distance, time, space, process, and form, appearance, form, all this, belief in a body, belief in a world, belief in, you know, that moments are bound together, and which is, you know, attempt to really sell God on what God did not create at all, what we're imagining. Isn't the ignorance of how to escape this, isn't that the very definition of a dark age? And it is the definition of a dark age. So the more materialistic we become, the darker the age is getting. And people are so distracted, they say, well, I can look anything I want to. I want to know what the football scores are. Let me look at my smartphone. Oh, okay, I know how the NFL did today. Great. You know, I'm really so advanced. And this is what I saw, was it's global. I saw people from all over the world, and you could just tell that this is their culture. This is what they're used to now, especially the young people. But really, 50, under 50, very heavily. People over 50, you can tell their different vibe about them. They're not so impressed by it all. But the under 50s, and especially the under 30s, are just, they're saying, you know, what else do we need to know? I mean, if it's not on my smartphone, it doesn't exist. And so very irreverent, irreligious, secular humanist, eco-religionist culture, global culture. This global culture right now is an abomination, great abomination, actually. But people think they're so advanced and they're so nice, you know, and they try to be, you know, they kind of celebrate with one another. Look at look how fortunate we are. We're living in the enlightened age. This is what they think. They're living in an enlightened age. You know, the civil rights and this rights. Oh, we're living in the rights. And yet they're totally ignorant. Beyond ignorant. It's way beyond ignorance. They're super defended against truth. So ignorance is one thing. You can deal with ignorance. But they've distanced and distracted themselves from truth. So there's a massive distraction to defensive complex, preventing them from even being able to remotely focus on truth at all. So that's way worse than ignorance. Way worse than ignorance. Give me ignorance anytime, and you can, you know, you can talk and introduce truth, and maybe there'll be some, you know, but there's nobody that's really ignorant of truth. They're all heavily defended against it. Heavily distracted against it. And of course, they're trying to sell this scenario to God, saying, God, this is your real creation. So they're trying to dress up all nice and beautiful and be nice to one another and say, look how happy we are, you know, here. This is tremendous. You know, look, God, what a great job you did. You know, this is what they're trying to do. They're faking it. It's all fake. It's all flimsy. It's all superficial. Nobody's really happy. If you look at people, is anybody really feeling this infinite lightness and infinite expansion and, you know, freedom? And no, they are not. They most certainly are not. And it's horrible. I mean, I don't know where to go to find that. I guess you have to go within, but wouldn't it be nice if there was some vibe like that in the world? There was no vibe at all. So for me, I say, well, 60 years is enough of this consciousness, of this sort of, you know, planetary consciousness here. Time to shift my consciousness out of this world. Now, whether the body stays or not, you know, I don't know. But certainly my consciousness, time to shift it off of this world. This world is an abomination from the very beginning. And why even bother trying to, you know, pretend like we're all happy with the world, you know? Well, first of all, everybody thinks that God believes that God is, you know, watching this world, and they think that God's really thrilled with the progress they're making. The truth is, God pays absolutely no attention to this world. Doesn't pay attention to bodies, personalities, this world. Absolutely no attention whatsoever. None. No special attention, let's put it that way. It's part of the allness. Even our dreams are part of the allness. But in terms of this idea that somehow God's watching our lives and say, oh, look at the progress they're making. Isn't this great? And aren't they happy? That's great. That's what I want to see in my children, you know. There's none of that whatsoever. None of that whatsoever. And this is, you know, mind-blowing to those who believe in this a personal God that's looking at our personality and thinking, oh, what a great, look at my handiwork. What a great job I've done. God did not have anything to do with this. Did nothing to do with it. And God knows it's just an attempt to scam God and try to convince God that this is what God created and not what God truly created. That's only a memory, false memory. So, it's, you know, it's just, how do you even begin to reach these people or do anything? It's just astonishing. Just astonishing. I mean, it's worst case scenario. I mean, you know, you hope for the best, prepare for the worst. I was told to prepare for the worst here, and I hope for the best. I you know, I really do. I really did hope that, as I think we all do, that hey, we're going to get with it. We're going to get serious here, and find out what our business is really about here in this world. Recognize what our true business is, which is salvation, from setting down this attempt at scamming God, setting down pretense, evaporating our continuity fear, abidance in the now. This is our business here, and that's it. And I thought for sure, you know, I was hoping that we would get with it, especially with the 60s and whatever was happening, the big push in the last century. You thought, you know, I hope this is going to, you know, it's going to work well. You know, hope for the best, prepare for the worst. And in having prepared for the worst, now I'm looking and seeing, it is a worst case scenario here. It really is a worst case scenario. People are drunk on superficiality. And they don't even realize there's anything else other than that. I mean, I hoped that at this time there would be enlightened beings walking the planet all over the place. You'd go into a hotel and there'd be someone there. You'd bump into them all the time. You'd be aware of them. I can't find even a faint trace of them. You know, it's just like the world is like spiritual wisdom has like vanished, like it's extinct. So, very, very worst case scenario. But having prepared for it now, so time to say, look, enough. The 60 years is more than enough to put your consciousness on this planet. It doesn't deserve even one day, actually. It doesn't even deserve 1 minute of our consciousness. But in honoring time, people demand that you spend your life honoring time this way. But hey, they forget the fact that we've incarnated many times. I've been here many, 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 many times. They think like each life is your first one. And I say, oh, you got to, give your honored time here. No, I've had many lifetimes where I honored time. I don't need to do it again. That's utterly ludicrous. So the very unawareness of reincarnation is an extraordinary ignorance and works against us severely. Because again, everyone says, well, at least you can do is spend your life honoring time. And if you say, well, I spent many lifetimes, they say, oh, you're crazy. No, 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 what are you talking about, crazy? No, I mean, how many lifetimes are we supposed to spend honoring time here on this planet? Give us a number. Don't just say you got to do it. Give us a number. How many lifetimes? 10, 20, 30? Right? People should be pinned down. Their attitude should be pinned down like that. We should flip the script back. So I think, awareness of reincarnation is extraordinarily important. I know Jesus says it's not ultimately important. But from my experience here, I would say the leverage it gives us is extraordinarily important. But, I also defer to Jesus in terms of the overall big picture, but he didn't want to emphasize it. But he did bring it up. He said it is a fact. But he says, don't try to make it like the ultimate emphasis, which I agree with that. But certainly, being aware of this, gives you some leverage, except everybody just ignores it here, which fits right in with the pretense here is that we got to keep honoring time to keep the scam going. So everyone just assumes this is your first time here and first and last time here, so you're obligated to honor time for your whole life. But like I said, 60 years is way more than enough to honor this garbage dump here. It's enough. So time to shift our consciousness into something much better, into abidance here. Time to shift consciousness into abidance and forget about this planet. Yeah, we don't really have to remember. I mean, a little bit. We've already, like I said, I've already given, 33 lives to honoring this planet and time. That's more than enough. Way more than enough. So that's it. Now we talked about the last video, abidance, that there's no choice, and the way to abide is to accept that you didn't make any choice at all. You don't need to make any choice. This is how God created us. So this is how we are. So we don't need to choose how to be what we are in order to be what we are. When we let go of the insistence that it's a choice, this opens the door to abidance, to realization of it. And so we can just say, well, I don't have a choice. Somebody says, well, you got to leave. So, well, I don't have a choice. No. Very powerful. So I have no choice. And then to practice, so our continuity fears evaporate. We say, I neither have a choice, nor do I not have a choice. I neither have a choice, nor do I not have a choice. So be sure to practice along with flipping the script. Remember, we have three parts to our practice. We have affirmations, we have full stop in the wow, flipping the script. So as we're talking here, flipping the script, and we realize we don't have a choice, and then start practicing it. Like, yes, I already know that I neither have a choice, nor do I not have a choice. Yes, I can know that I neither have a choice, nor not have a choice. Yes, I will know that I neither have a choice, nor do I not have a choice. Yes, I already know that I neither have a choice, nor not have a choice. Which puts us in a neutral, not choosing position, which opens our mind to what is, what already is the case, without having to choose it. Choiceless awareness, they call it by dance. It's another way, choiceless awareness. It's not the result of saying, well, I chose this. This is why I'm experiencing it. No, I was created this way. That's why I'm experiencing it. Starting to warm up, starting to heat up in California again. Absolutely it is. Another little mini heat wave will come busting through here. I neither reject that I have a choice, nor do I not reject that I have a choice. I neither reject that I have a choice, nor do I not reject that I have a choice. How does that go? Yeah. I neither reject that I have a choice, nor do I not reject that I have a choice. There you go. So this is the right form to put in something that our continuity fear is afraid to deal with. Like what we'd say, that we don't have a choice. So if we start off saying, I neither reject that I have a choice. So you're saying the continuity fear, well, I'm not rejecting that, the notion we have a choice. And then you say, nor do I not reject that I have a choice. So You're not rejecting that you have a choice, meaning you're saying, I mean, you're not rejecting you're not rejecting, see, how's that go? No. I neither reject that I have a choice, nor do I not reject that I have a choice. My mind's a little slow at the moment. So sometimes you'll find that if you're a little sleepy, a little tired, you're not quite as sharp in terms of formulating your practicing. So, but don't worry about that. This happens. You know, you're not always going to be, you know, totally sharp about it. Reject that I have a choice, nor do I not reject I'm not rejecting that I have a choice, but nor am I not rejecting it. You could say, I'm neither rejecting that I have a choice, nor am I accepting that I have a choice. But if you say not rejecting, that means that you are rejecting. You see? Okay, so neither am I rejecting that I have a choice, nor am I not rejecting. So I'm not rejecting that I have a choice, which means I'm really rejecting. It's just a very compassionate way of putting it. Instead of saying, I neither reject that I have a choice, nor do I accept that I have a choice. That puts it a little, you know, bolder way. But if you say, I'm neither rejecting that I have a choice, nor am I not rejecting that I have a choice. So if I'm not rejecting, then I'm rejecting. See, a double negative is a positive there, right? I'm not rejecting. So it means I am rejecting that I have a choice. But we're not saying that directly, you see? So this is very kind to our continuity fear. You say, hey, don't worry, continuity fear. I'm not rejecting that. I'm not rejecting the notion we have a choice, nor am I not rejecting. I'm neither rejecting that I have a choice, nor am I not rejecting that I have a choice. Now the continuity fear knows, okay, you know, you're gradually making progress here, but it says that's okay, as long as you honor our continuity fear, you honor your creativity, and you put it in this way, it doesn't really bother me. So it's like walking very slowly and quietly, so you don't disturb a jittery animal or something, and the animal, like a deer, the animal's looking at you, and as long as you go real quiet and slow, they'll say, okay. They won't bolt on you, right? If you've ever been around wild animals, you know that if you let them know, say, hey, okay, and just walk real slow and calm, they're looking at you very intently for any aggressive behavior. Show no aggressive behavior whatsoever. They'll say, oh, not a threat. No threatening behavior. No threatening body language, nothing. Okay, same thing with this practice. You know, nothing threatening in here. I'm neither rejecting that I don't reject that I have a choice, nor am I not rejecting that I have a choice. I'm neither rejecting that there is choice, so I'm not rejecting that there's choice, but nor am I not rejecting. So you say, well, I'm not rejecting it, but I say, not rejecting. I'm neither rejecting and nor not rejecting. In other words, not rejecting. So if I'm not rejecting, I must be rejecting. See, double, if I'm not rejecting, I must be rejecting. If you're not doing something, it means you're doing something. Right? So nor am I not rejecting choice means I'm rejecting the notion of choice. So it's time to get down to business. We have this time frame now, and it's very obvious. October, we have to decide, you know, what are we going to do? Which, are we going to go into the Stone Age, Gilded Stone Age, or are we going to escape it? It's a very nasty trap, personality trap, flimsy, superficial, gaudy success, and underneath, you know, extreme defensiveness and distancing and delay. You're not dealing with ignorant people here. You're dealing with people with very sophisticated distraction defenses built in. This is the trouble in this world, is this world is now populated by very sophisticated, those who have very sophisticated defenses, egoic defenses, very sophisticated. And, you know, talk about delaying. I mean, they're heavily into delay, which is why they're focusing on the superficial so much. Makes them feel, you know, Look, it's worth it. It's safe. It's just part of their defensive nature. So how do you get through to those people? Well, that's you know, may not happen for quite some time. You cannot just go directly through massive defense system like that. The whole planet has been turned into a defensive system, actually. A global defensive system, global egoic defensive system here, that is just rendering, you know, focus, right focus here, you know, more and more like it's almost impossible. And I say by the end of June 21st, let's say, 2016, it will be, the idea of starting out at that point then is virtually impossible. And if we haven't got down to business by that time, we won't. This is how I feel, that the ignorance, the misdirection, the distraction, the globalization of all this will become so intense by this time, June 21st, 2016, that if you're not already familiar with spiritual practice, I don't see how you can get familiar with it. It'll just seem so irrelevant, like it doesn't exist. So we certainly want to be well practiced by that time, so it seems like our basic nature to do so. And it is our basic nature. Ultimately, getting to this realization, acceptance of no choice, practicing this, this is getting to it. This is what's called really getting to it. Jesus gave us a couple of milestones. He said, one of them is, I don't need to do anything. And the corollary of that also goes along with that. There isn't any choice I need to make, really. It's not really a question of choice at all. It might seem to be from one's perspective, but from the ultimate perspective, there's no choice. We don't have a choice. We cannot leave what we are. We cannot change what we are. So where's the choice? There isn't any. So he said, when you reach those milestones and you're able to do this practice, and then he said, that means you've had a successful spiritual path and you've gone in the right direction. And you're virtually there. You're virtually there. That's how you know. And so that's why I'm confident in saying that, you know, these videos represent, you know, getting there. When we're able to do these practices like this, that means we've had a successful spiritual path. We're really far along. If we can get our attention off of this planet, you know, then how do we, into abidance, then how do we keep it there? Well, various ways we're looking at. We don't have any choice. That's maybe the most powerful. We don't have any choice in the matter. There's nowhere I can go except into just fantasy, which is nowhere, also nowhere. So it's a lose-lose situation, doesn't gain anything. And say that I'm using this for practice. So I'm entered into oneness. I've neither entered into oneness, nor have I not entered into oneness. I've neither entered into oneness, nor have I not entered into oneness. So we can use it as practice. So unfortunately, what we've been warned about from various sources has turned out to be correct. Krishnamurti, for instance, was one source. The Bible has been another source. Holy Spirit's been another source. Intuition's been another, you know, our own intuition. And you can probably find other sources actually warning us about this time. Krishnamurti was right on the button. He said he had his consciousness was able to align with the Christ consciousness, as he called it. And this is what he told us would happen. There'd be the planet would be populated fairly soon, he said, by this different type of consciousness, some consciousness that's heavily focused on in sophisticated materiality, and they will be very, very organized with advanced organizational techniques, and they would take over the planet. And he said, actually, this is going to be a very, very bad thing. Well, I mean, he nailed it, absolutely nailed it. You talk about an accurate prophecy, that was it. And nobody even brings that up anymore. I don't know which book that was in. You know, it's like ignored. But I remember reading that, and I was so stunned by it. I said, wow, this sounds like what's happening. You know, I see the... Well, at that time, I said, wow, I hope that doesn't happen. Let's see if it does. Well, it has happened. No question about it. He absolutely was accurate in his statement. So, you know, and... as far as theosophy goes, and the United Nations and all this Gilded Stone Age, keep in mind that the theosophists, which is what this new world order, new age of Aquarius, is all based on theosophy, and a lot of what Joaquin had to say, and believing we're coming into this very advanced time in the world where everyone works in groups and synthesizes their efforts together and stuff like that. Well, keep in mind that they said that a great world teacher would come into the world and would lead us into the new age. Okay, this was their teaching. They were sure this was going to happen. And they were sure that Krishnamurti was that world teacher. Okay, they found him on a beach in Adyar, near now modern Chennai. It used to be Madras, I believe. And the Theosophical Society had a large headquarters there near the beach. And... one of the psychics, I think it was Ledbetter, saw Krishnamurti walking on a beach. He said, oh, look at this, look at his aura, you know, we got to go talk to him. I think this is the one we've been looking for. And so they talked to him, and ultimately they brought him up and educated him and, you know, adopted him. The family allowed that, and they groomed him to be the new world teacher that would lead us into the age of Aquarius, the new age, the great, you know, millennium. So he was schooled in all this theosophy, and they thought this was true teaching. And the only problem was is that one day Krishnamurti, I think he was in Holland, Netherlands somewhere, at some big mansion they had there, and they had some huge meeting of theosophists and all these, you know, new world, these leaders of the new world order, and they're saying it's coming, here's the Messiah. And he brought them all together and said, I have an announcement. I'm not your world spiritual teacher. I'm not leading you into a new age. And this teaching of theosophy and all this is not true. It's not true. And he resigned resigned. So that's pretty extraordinary that the one that theosophy thought was the new world teacher repudiated it. How extraordinary is that? And he said, truth is a pathless land. You're going about it in the wrong way. This is a dualism. Now dualism can be thought of as believing that we have a choice as far what our identity is. We can either choose this or choose that, and maybe this one over here is a better choice, but we still have a choice. And the idea of choosing is kind of the I. So the I is like the chooser. We think that we have to make a choice, so we think there's some self that's aware that the choice is possible and needs to make that choice. So we're trying to make an educated choice. So we're trying to raise, you know, advance this I into a new world age, new world order, where the I will become very smart and say, okay, I know how to choose properly, you know. This is delusion. This is duality. The idea that there's two-ness, that there's a choice of what our identity is, and the idea that there's a chooser is self-delusion. That's duality. If there's no choice, how could there be a chooser? But everybody thinks that they're evolving their chooser. And as their chooser evolves, the chooser more and more sees, oh, yeah, I see, I've seen the two identities better. Which one do I choose? Something like that. But so there is no I, really. If there's no choice, how can there be a chooser? This is just a delusion. If there's no choice, how could there be a chooser? Just let reason take a look at that. So, I'm neither rejecting choosing nor am I not rejecting choosing. Neither choosing nor am I not rejecting choosing. I'm neither rejecting choosing nor am I not rejecting choosing. So to get to this point then means that I feel it's significant. We'll see how significant it turns out to be, if there's some collegiality showing up in some way. Because I feel that getting to this point of pinning it down now to recognizing there isn't any choice is really like the holy grail of the path, really. And I haven't been able to get to this. This is the first time I've really gotten here in such a clear way, which is rather astonishing. It just shows how ingrained it is within us that somehow it's up to us to make some right choice. You know? And therefore the I becomes very important. We must educate the I. But if there's no choice, why do we need to be educating an I and educating a self? Why do we need a planet? Why do we need a body to so-called learn, you know, how to make a right choice? Isn't this just a delaying tactic, the whole idea? Because we can always say, well, I don't feel quite ready yet to make this very important choice. I need more time. There isn't any important choice we need to make. There's no choice at all we need to make. In fact, there's no choice we can make, actually. We are what we are, and nothing other than what we are. So there's no choice involved in it whatsoever. Now, ultimately, abidance springs from this recognition, but apparently it's not easy to get to this recognition, or I would have gotten to it earlier. It's partly because you don't hear anyone emphasizing it. You hear Jesus emphasizing it, but you say, well, that's Jesus. But it's helpful if one of us here in this world starts emphasizing it too. And then you might say, huh, you know, this is not some, you know, formless spirit channeling through somebody, or somebody who actually seems to be appearing in the world, and they're saying it too. Okay, that's interesting. So this you know, technological age, artificial age of artificial intelligence, AI is so full of so many distractions that people tend to think, hey, you know, there isn't anything that we're being distracted from. There's so much distraction. Rather than say, wow, there's a ton of distraction, that's really bad, they just say, oh, no, there's nothing, there's no distraction, because there's nothing to be distracted from. So, I don't need to do anything, I can just, everything's fine. So it may become prohibitively difficult 9 months from now, for anybody to look at the world, start out and just say, hey, you know, wow, there's so much distraction that's terrible. I need to turn to spiritual truth right now. It may be they'll just say, wow, it's overwhelming. I don't even want to think about trying to deal with all this stuff. So let me just pretend, let me just say, well, there must not be any spiritual truth to look at and call it good. And the world is likely to be in that sort of condition very soon. More and more and more and more, more caving in and just saying, oh no, what, you know, we're supposed to be humans here, and if we just strive for equality, we all can be happy here. And, you know, put a humanist twist on it all. And the temptation may be overwhelming very soon. This is the concern. This is the urgency of the Holy Spirit. Things may be so screwed up here that you just think, wow, it's easier just to say there isn't any goal, you know, to get, there is no freedom from this. There is no goal. So why don't we just accept it as it is and just say, you know, nothing I can do about it. This may become an overwhelming burden for us here. Because it's hard enough just to keep your momentum that you already have in the world right now. Even if you've been practicing for a lifetime, it's become very difficult to keep the momentum going. But to get started, you know, that just is, it might become very difficult. So we want to make hay while the sun is shining, still shining here. And we haven't just doubled down on self-delusion. So I continue to do follow-ups. I think it's responsible. It's responsible to do this. So you know, that's why the videos come every day, because the previous video was such a breakthrough, so intense and such a big breakthrough, such a big shift. It's important to follow up on it and say, yeah, everything's fine. Everything's going forward fine. It's all meshing together. It's all great. Otherwise, you know, I think people reasonably say, well, wait a minute, you know, what happened? Is there some problem with this? You know, it's like you're pioneering something, you need to give regular reports on it just to reassure that everything's going fine. Cut off communication, and then people will start wondering, whoa, something bad happened. So really, at some point, you just hang on. It's like a roller coaster. At some point, you're going upside down. You're just hanging on, right? I mean, you just say, "Wow, this is quite a ride." But if I just hang on, I'll be fine. So the more we get familiar with this, the more we get used to it, the easier it is, the easier it is, the easier it is. And very important to take care of business right now, the next 9 months. Crucial, 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 most crucial time in history, the next 9 months. So that you're tuned in, you know your options, and getting closer to being able to recognize that we don't have any choice, actually. That those who are pretending that they're just still deciding what to choose, you know. No, there's no choice. They're wasting their time. It's the truth. They're wasting their time. It's just a delaying action. It's just honoring the time. We have no choice as to what we are. None whatsoever. So how could there be a choice to make, and how could there be a chooser? And how could there be a choosing? None of those three exist. But we can pretend that we're just trying to decide what we are, you know, evolving what we are. Delaying tactics. We can evolve a dream, change a dream any way we want, make call it evolving. You know, oh yeah, sure, the dream's evolving because we have this gradualism in it, but can't we dream a dream of gradualism? Of course we can. How does that make it less a dream if it's a dream of gradualism? It's still a dream. It's still denying the perfection that we are right now, that we are created perfect, and we're not an evolving spirit. We're an experiencing spirit, but not an evolving spirit. Okay, very great. We don't need to make it too long. This is a nice follow-up, and again, we're getting to this really, really tremendous milestone here. The neither nor practice has brought us here, and seeing that there isn't any choice, and practicing, I neither reject choice nor do I not reject choice. I neither reject that I have a choice, nor do I not reject that I have a choice. I neither accept that there is no choice, nor do I not accept that there is no choice. I neither accept that I have no choice, nor do I not accept that I have no choice. I neither accept that I have no choice, nor do I not accept that I have no choice. Now, to help people out, I do these videos, and I'm trying to, you know, provide enough content, you know, for not watching television. What do you do? You know, it's time to draw a line. You're not watching television, not on your smartphone. You know, not watching movies by any means. No movies, no TV, no radio. No time to draw a line for all that. What do? It's a question. Well, generally speaking, the videos with graphics in them have not got as many views, really, or as much interest. It's understandable. But it is a way to pass some time. At least it keeps you in the ballpark. It keeps your attention. You say, I know there's something important here with these teachers. I know, you know, what is it? So it keeps a certain amount of inquiry going on, rather than just taking a, you know, vacation from it all. You know, stay engaged with it. Try to stay engaged with it. But ultimately, I guess these upgrades are people tend to I have more interest in those because, you know, they can relate. It's right here, right now. Someone right here, right now, talking about right here, right now. What are the pressures that we are under right here, right now? Why are we under these pressures? What is the danger? What are the consequences of failure? How about success? You know, and all this stuff is you know, right up to the moment, right up to the moment here, from the belly of the beast. Like Jonah and the whale, the belly of the beast, like in Nineveh here, Jonah wandering around Nineveh today, and looking at the Ninevites, these sophisticated savages here, absolutely sophisticated savages. No more or less than Ninevites back in the time, right? And but I don't see anybody saying repent, repent, repent. I don't see any signs anymore of religious activity out on the street or anywhere. It's all cloistered in the churches, and they're under assault too. And they're teaching a mixed message of, you know, eco-religion, humanist religionists. Combination of religionism and humanism is taking place right now. And you get this bizarre hybrid from that. That many think, well, we're taking the best of both, taking the best of humanism, taking the best of religionism, and we're coming up with this new synthesis. This is all about group synthesis. Oh yeah, synthesis. What are you synthesizing? Is truth something you synthesize? Or are you trying to synthesize two different lies, or two similar lies, to come up with a third lie, which seems temporarily, you know, brilliant? You say, well, it's not that one. That one wasn't quite it, and this one wasn't quite it. But you put them together, and look what we've got. We've really synthesized something awesome. But it helps to have somebody who's been there, done that. I mean, we were doing selfies 10 years ago extensively, and everybody's looking at us like, what are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? And I just figured it out, you know. I just said, oh yeah, we'll just do a selfie here. And people just didn't generally do that. They always have somebody else take a picture for them. You know, you're like Cypress Point, Monterey. You say, click, click, click. Someone takes pictures. Oh, could you take a picture of us? Click, click. And I just go there and I just do a selfie, you know, and people say, oh, you want me to take your picture? I said, no, we got it like this. That was like 10 years ago. And now everybody's like, oh, I got a selfie stick, you know, wireless selfie stick. I can walk around, stand in front of a statue, and click, here I am in front of a statue. And then I can put it on Facebook and send it to my friends. Everybody's, oh my gosh, this is the new age. So the bloom is off the rose for all this stuff. Pictures, video, you know, all social media, all this stuff. The bloom is off the rose here. So I'm just, you know, underwhelmed by it. Totally underwhelmed. I realize it's much ado about nothing. Yeah, really. Just a distraction. Apple computers, the master of distraction. They absolutely are. You know, the wizard of distraction. And say, oh my gosh, aren't you sophisticated? You got a little thinner, more sleeker smartphone here, and look at the higher resolution pictures you can take. You can take a higher resolution selfie of yourself by the pool, and then, you know, you can tell your friends, look what I'm doing, I'm by my pool. And everyone says, wow, we're like in the new age now, we're new agers. Which equates to, I guess, being in the know. We're in the know now. I just read a Twitter from some celebrity. I'm in the know. But are we in the know about salvation? Who's in the know about salvation? And of course, what they want to do is get rid of anyone who's in the know, so they can all walk around and say, well, we don't see anybody, so we must be in the know. There's no one to compare us to, so yeah. Well, let's just define ourselves as being in the know. We'll be self-professed in the know. And nothing to compare it with to say otherwise, so must be good. Is this logic, or is this insanity, or is this the logic of insanity? They of course ignore the historical examples. This is something I try to keep alive. The historical examples is so important, but everyone's just ignoring them. And what can you do? As part of the defensive system, they just say, I have no interest in looking at anything that's mythological. They just call it all myth. All history is myth to them. Especially the history of those who are spiritually enlightened in the past. It's just myth. You know, that doesn't, not really relevant to anything at all. It's just sort of some sort of dysfunction of the brain. You know, they had some sort of epilepsy or something or whatever. But that's treatable now. So we don't really need to worry about that. We know how to treat that now. Double frontal lobotomy or something. And I go through the eye socket, ice pick, a lobotomy or something. That, you know, now they're more sophisticated. They'll just use lasers to like fry it all, turn it into mush. And I say, oh yeah, see, they're cured. Surgery was successful, of course, and the patient is doing well, resting well, and they feel very relieved from these delusions of God that they used to have, and we're looking forward to them leading a well-adjusted life in this enlightened age. And everyone can feel very good about themselves that we're finally be able to even treat those terrible problems we used to have in the past, those terrible people tormented by, you know, visions of God and God speaking to them and directing them. Oh my God, you know, this horrible torment they must have gone through. It's such appalling shame, you know. I mean, they must have been mortified to be subject to this mental disorder that they had. Holy cow, but that's okay. It's just a brain, it's just a chemical brain imbalance. And we've got the tools now to finally deal with that, and hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is it any wonder that everyone here is kind of circumspect, say, I don't want to be too successful here on the spiritual path. They might get out the lasers, you know. And they tell me, they're very reassuring. Don't worry. It's all okay. We'll very compassionate. We'll take care of that. It's easy to take care of. We know how to, you know, we're very compassionate now. In the past, wow, they're so lacking in compassion and telling them. They didn't help those people at all. In fact, they even actually encouraged them by coming to them and asking them questions and stuff. I mean, that's just like, you know, very, very, very barbaric actions to encourage this sort of thing. Holy cow. Yeah, those people were really ignorant back then. But these days, we just ignore it and treat it effectively, and then it's gone, and then we, you know, never, like, it's never there, we never even bring it up. We don't want to embarrass them. So, you know, I mean, you used to believe in God and see God, and, oh, well, we don't want to embarrass you about that. Let's just not even talk about it. You know, give them a job picking up cigarette butts somewhere. Cleaning out ashtrays, saying have a nice day, and what a compassionate society we have. What an advanced society. What a progressive society. What a forward-looking society. What a new age. What an Aquarian age, where we value everyone and their input, and even the lobotomized janitor over there, we value their input too. When they say have a nice day, we say, you know, see, they're with the program too. They're on the same, we're all on the same page here. That makes us feel good. We're not leaving anyone behind except for God. But of course they say that, we know that's a myth now, you know, that was just a myth. So leaving a myth behind is progress. Heavy, heavy continuity fear here in this world. It's just how you measure the darkness of it. If you want to measure it all, it's a darkness of the world. How much continuity fear is at play? And there's all these folks coming from various parts unknown incarnating on this planet who are heavy, heavy continuity fear addicts. They're so heavy they think this is all there is. They can't imagine otherwise. So... you know, not a nice place to visit right now, planet Earth, I'd say. It's kind of, it needs to be, as far as a vacation spot, it should be quarantined. It should be this universal quarantine on planet Earth right now. Temporarily, the site is closed. It's too dangerous. It's like something like Beirut or something like Damascus or wherever right now. Nineveh, or what's that place now? Anyway, it, you know, it's like taken over by terrorists and it's in Iraq. What's that other place in Iraq? And, you know, nobody's going to go there as a tourist right now. It's officially shut down. No flights in. No flights in to that place. It's way too dangerous. This is the way this planet should be. It should be quarantined and no flights allowed into this place. No, shouldn't allow incarnations into this world, actually. But you can't stop it. Those who want to revel in the insanity are going to come in. But certainly, let's not have any tourism here. Too dangerous. Too dangerous. And if we really want to come back here, we'll have to wait a while, you know, until some of the dust clears. Get some of the dust out of their minds. So, we're waiting for something. Collegiality, you know, I'm waiting for collegiality. Come on, time for collegiality. We've reached this. There is no choiceness. And reaching that, you know, is kind of like a stamp on your passport. You know, you're a fellow passportee, and you've got the stamp, the visa stamp on there. So should hopefully collegiality starts happening. This is what I feel needs to happen, is we need to start, those who are of like mind need to start, you know, recognizing it and, you know, two thumbs up for it. Says great. And this collegiality needs to kind of spread, and we realize that we're not alone. We're not isolated. We're not alone. And we share in the humor and the outlook and all of that. So hopefully next step is collegiality, and I get that ball rolling here. Meeting colleagues that have the same, you know, perspective, same viewpoint. You know, we'll see. All right, very great. I think we hit the hour mark on this, which is good. And this is a follow-up to the follow-up to the follow-up to the follow-up, and breakthrough, follow-up. And we'll keep trying to follow up and keep reassuring that we can do this. We can do it. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.